We have two types, sexual and we have asexual. And in the lab, you're getting the asexual part. I'm going to tell you a little about the sexual part this morning, which is done primarily by breeding by the use of seeds. Now, ordinarily, we do not plant seeds like you do lettuce seeds, radish seeds, tomato seeds, and whatnot to propagate grapevines. Because seeds do not breed true to character. So if you want something to breed true, you have to use asexual propagation, which you are getting in the lab. But to develop new varieties, we have to resort to sexual propagation because each seed is a different character. We have several new breeders, relatively new breeders, of fruit varieties. And a few of them I'll give you here. Of course, we have in our own department Professor Olmo, who's developing fruiting varieties. And I think you probably know him mostly for Ruby Cabernet and Emerald Riesling. And on the table varieties, he'd be known very well for Perlet. He has a few other varieties he's also released. But these are probably the most well-known varieties and the most widely planted. Professor Leiter in our department is working primarily on rootstocks. And his chief interest has been with rootstocks that are resistant not only to phylloxera, because most of our rootstocks that we are using today are resistant to phylloxera, but he's also working on rootstocks that are resistant to phylloxera and to nematodes. So he's getting resistance to both types. Now, 15 to 20 years ago, when we spoke of resistance to nematodes, we were only thinking one type of a nematode, the root knot. That's the one that formed a little round ball on your roots, very similar to sugar beet nematodes, to the nematodes that infect tomatoes, plants like that. They form these big round galls, and these are our root knot nematodes. And this has been the most common that's known for the past years. We've had a few rootstocks that are resistant to root knot nematode. But now, with the more of a development of nematology, we also have the root lesion nematode, the Pratelincus species. These are the types that do not form these galls on the nematode. They form just lesions or dead areas where they feed on the roots themselves. And you might say they're almost as serious, if not more serious, than the root knot, because it's a lesion nematode, type of lesion that can spread one of our main virus diseases. So Dr. Leiter is more interested really in developing resistance to the lesion nematode, because most of our rootstocks have no resistance to lesion nematodes. The USDA has had two well-known breeders, Elmer Snyder at Fresno, and probably his most well-known variety is Cardinal. Very well-known variety, very well-liked variety, very well-liked variety. Best varieties there is for your backyard. And then there's Dr. John Weinberger, he's not only a grape breeder, he's also a peach and nectarine breeder. He comes from back east, from Georgia, and he had developed several good peach and nectarine varieties down there. He was transferred out here to Fresno, and about 2 years ago, he came out with a rootstock adapted down south called Harmony. It's one safe for the interior valley where you have primarily nematodes. It's supposed to also have some phylloxera resistance. As far as the lesion nematode, unfortunately, it does not have any of that type of resistance. It is a rootstock that is supposed to compete with our most widely known rootstock for that type of an area, 1613. And then just recently, in fact, just this year, he has also released a new rootstock called Freedom. It's been tested for about the last 5 years. It is supposed to be one in between Harmony or 1613 and our most resistant, our most vigorous rootstock, Dog Ridge and Salt Creek. Those two rootstocks are resistant to both phylloxera and nematodes. They are extremely vigorous. We only recommend them in sandy soils. I mean sand piles. I don't mean loamy sand. I mean a real sand pile because they have too much vigor. And this is supposed to fill that gap in between the 1613, which cannot take poor fertility, sandy soil, and the Dog Ridge and Salt Creek, which have too much soup to them. So this is supposed to fill that gap. There's also one other breeder. He is primarily a nectarine breeder, but he has developed one or two grape varieties. Fred Anderson down here out of Merced at La Grande. He's primarily known for his nectarines, but he's also played around with some grape varieties. And I think he has probably sold one or two to commercial nurseries, and they'll be coming out in the future. So these are the main breeders we have, of course, Dr. Olmo, Dr. Leiter, Elmer Snyder, and Weinberger out here in the West. Now, as far as developing commercial varieties, you can go one of two ways. When you develop a variety, you either cross varieties, in other words, you cross, say, Rabier and Red Malaga, or this is known as a cross, or you self. In other words, the self, you take the same variety of stuff, it could be Rabier, and you cross it with itself, meaning you put a bag over the cluster, let it pollinate itself, and get your seeds and plant the seeds in this manner. Now, there has been no commercial variety developed by selfing. Whenever you self, you lose vigor, you go downhill, the seedlings are always very weak, they never amount to a hill of beans. So as far as developing varieties by selfing, it's out. The only way that you can maintain vigor in a variety is by crossing at least with another variety. In other words, you cannot inbreed, you have to outbreed all the time. Now, surprising to say that most of the work that has been done with breeding has been done to develop rootstocks rather than varieties. And the reason for this is because of our friend Phylloxera that got started in Europe. It came from the United States, got into Europe, and the conditions were so lush in Europe for its development, or it even developed wings so it could spread faster, that it practically wiped out the European vineyards. And this occurred between 1860 and 1880 when it practically devastated the vineyards in Europe. So in other words, when the Europeans saw this occurring, they had to get off the stick and try to find out some way to overcome their problem. First, of course, they found some of our rootstocks over here that were resistant to phylloxera, so they imported those and started using them. But at the same time, they also wanted to get away with the idea of having to plant a rootstock and then either bud it or graft it, or bench graft in the building and go out in the nursery with your bench grafts and end up with a bench grafted vine. Yeah?
Isn't importing of the rootstocks the way the blocks were originally got to France?
That's the way we got it. In other words, the Europeans over there came over here and they saw that we had wild species growing that could stand some of their poor soil conditions they had over there. So they said, ah, this is for us. So fine, they brought them over there to take care of their poor soil conditions, but in so doing, they also brought over the phylloxera with it, which they didn't realize, and this is what wiped out their vineyards over there. But this idea of having the graft, or having the bud, or having the bench graft is for the birds. So they decided, well, why can't we do some crossing some of these species we're using for rootstocks with some of our fruiting varieties, and thereby develop a variety you can grow on its own roots, and it'll produce the fruit for your wine or for your table varieties, but also has this resistance not only to phylloxera, but also to downy mildew, which was their second nemesis. Their weather conditions over there are lush, they're moist, they have frequent rains, ideal for the development of particularly downy mildew, which fortunately we don't have in California. We have powdery mildew, but we don't have downy mildew. So this is what the breeders got busy doing. In other words, they started to try to develop hybrids, not only of varieties that were resistant to these two troubles, so they wouldn't have to bud or graft or go through all that rigmarole. They also were trying to develop rootstocks that were resistant to phylloxera and also had resistance to some of their high lime soils or some of their high clay soils. This is where their problems were. They had a lot of soils that were very high in lime, or they had soils that were heavy in clay, which gave them problems developing vineyards, particularly on their own roots. So you had two sets of breeders at work, those that were working on rootstocks for these poor soil conditions, and those that were trying to develop varieties that you could grow on their own roots and not have to go through all this rigmarole of some type of budding or grafting. I'll give you an example. We have some over here. Now, this actually are a list of some of the rootstocks and actually some of the crosses involved. There's 41B, and it's Millardet of DeGrasse. And he actually made a cross. Now, the first variety is considered to be the female variety. Chasselas, which is a well-known, most well-known table varieties in Europe, your Chasselas Doré, makes an excellent wine. He crossed it with Berlandieri back in 1882. So in other words, most of these are way back in the 1800s when they got busy on this. It's a fairly well-known rootstock over there. 1103 by Paulson. That's one of them he put out. He put out several more besides 1103s. He just used numbered series. But in other words, there were Berlandieri rupestris hybrids. This happens to be our good old St. George here. Another breeder, Richter, had two famous ones, 99R and 110R, and they are Berlandieri rupestris hybrids. Our well-known 1613 that we use down in the valley, our nematode-resistant rootstock, as well as our 1616, was developed by Kudork, and it's a Solanus, S-O-L-O-N-I-S, with a riparia, not with a rupestris. In other words, we have three main species that we use. We use Berlandieri, we use rupestris, we use riparia. Now, this is incorrect the way I write this because it really should be vitis and then a little letter like that. But when we make the cross, we leave off the vitis and just put the species down, and it saves a lot less writing. So this is the way you see this now. But the correct way should be a vitis rupestris, vitis Berlandieri, vitis riparia, and these would really all be with a small letter there. Yeah?
Didn't he use something called Othello in one of those crosses?
1613 is a Solanus and Othello, yes. But in other words, I just threw this in here along with the 1616. The 1613 is actually Solanus with Othello.
And Othello
Yeah, or no, I think it's a Labrusca. And then Teleki had a bunch of hybrids, and his probably most important ones are the 5BB and the 8B, Berlandieri Riparia. And then the most recent one now is the one that's come out of the Oppenheim School. It was one of Teleki's hybrids, is number 4, but it was tested there at Oppenheim in Germany and released from there, and it probably is one of the best ones that they're using right now. In addition to that, we also had some breeders that were working with fruiting varieties. These were the rootstock breeders. We have those that work with fruiting varieties, and these are some of the men that worked on them. And they didn't give them names as we know them. They gave them a whole bunch of numbers. And since we do not use the French hybrids, these are all French hybrids or direct producers, I'm not going to go into these details. They use some of these back in New York. They do well back there. But for most purposes, the quality of the French hybrids does not compare with our vinifera varieties. So we do not use them. This is one problem. The other problem is these hybrids are resistant to phylloxera. Fine, that's excellent. And they're also resistant to downy mildew, which we don't need. So in other words, if the quality isn't going to be there and the resistance isn't exactly what we want, we don't even use them. So you will not hear much of these French hybrids being used in California. You'll hear about a few of them being used in the eastern states. You'll hear one or two being used up in Oregon and Washington. Okay, now, let me give you a few examples of different types of crosses that we work with. The most common, of course, would be vinifera times vinifera. And a well-known one would be the Tokay crossed with Ribeir. And what does that give us? It gives us cardinal. And that was done in 1946. Give you another example. In 1948, Dr. Omel says, well, why can't we develop a Cabernet for the valley? So he figured, well, Cabernet would be the best parent for the Cabernet flavor, so he decided to use that, but he also wanted a little better production what Cabernet offers. So he figured, well, shucks, Carrigan is a beautiful variety, has good production, has nice big clusters, you don't have to waste much time harvesting. So he crossed Carrigan with Cabernet. And he finally selected out of that lot from that cross, Ruby Cabernet. And he also said, well, we should also have a white Riesling type that we can grow down in the valley, too. And Muscadel was a good one, a good variety for that. It had the qualities that he wanted, had a little bit of Muscat flavor, and he had good production, so he crossed that with white Riesling, which had really the quality he wanted, but it didn't have production, and he ended up with Emerald Riesling. So there's two good examples of a vinifera cross with a vinifera. All right, I'll give you an example of a cross of a vinifera with another species. In other words, this would be an interspecific, as contrasted over here with intra. Meaning within the species, within the vinifera itself. Now here's the interspecific, we're crossing a vinifera with a rupestris. And the most common one that we know of here in California, taking up some 10,000 acres, is Salvador. Little black one. It has a typical leaf of rupestris, small clusters, and you, of course, if you break them, they're jet black. So that's probably the best one there I can give you for two species. I'll tell you a little about the time it takes now to develop a new variety. We say a minimum of 10 years to develop a new variety. Why does it take so long? It seems ridiculous. Okay. Let's start for an example now. We'll talk about Dr. Olmo's breeding of this something he eventually named as Ruby Red. He started back in 1958, and he wanted something that would replace this Salvador because it was just too hard to pick. It had good color, but had little tiny clusters. So he wanted something that had bigger clusters, even a little better production. Pardon? No, I don't have that. That's why I didn't tell you. But in other words, it's an old variety. We don't even have the parentage on that. Okay, so we know the variety Alicante Gansin. It's somewhat similar to Alicante Boucher, only the color is stable in this variety. It does not settle out. It not only has color in the skins, but it also has color in the juice, very heavy colored. And he crossed that, this is the female parent, with Trousseau. Fairly good production. And let's say this was done right now for ease of understanding. This was done, well, let's do it now, 1974. You make the cross, okay? To make the cross, you wait until June. And the flowers come out just before the little caps are shed. The clipters come off. The breeder gets out there on a stool, and sometimes he has a windscreen over him. He puts on, right now he's lucky, he has these goggles he can wear that magnify what he's doing. But you have to take these clusters in your hand, and you have to take a pair of tweezers, and you have to tweak off each little clipter, which removes the cap and the anthers without this breaking or injuring the little pistil. And he does that to every little flower on there that hasn't shed its cap. If a flower on the cluster has shed its cap, he yanks that off because maybe it's pollinated itself. So he does this for a whole cluster, sitting there very gently, giving a really tender loving care so you don't injure those things. And as he pulls off these little caps, he also counts the number of pistils that are left on there. So when he gets through, he has a count of the number of flowers that he's going to pollinate. Now, if he's lucky to have the pollen variety blooming at the same time, then he just merely goes over to the vine that has the pollen variety, comes back, and dusts all those pistils with the pollen variety. If the pollen is not ready yet, then he puts a bag over that cluster and seals it fairly tightly, and then waits till his pollen is ready. And if he has to wait long, or sometimes he has to, say, go down to Fresno County where the variety might be in bloom early, bring up his pollen. And if he has enough clusters, he will dust that on there. If he does not have enough clusters, then he's going to do quite a bit of pollinating with this particular variety, then he will dust the pollen off on a piece of glass, collect the pollen with a razor blade, put it in a small vial, and then take the end of a lead pencil. We used to use a camel's hair brush. That's no longer used. It's for the birds. Just take the end of a lead pencil and the pollen will adhere to it. You stick it in a vial or you stick it in a Petri dish and you go over and you dust each little flower on there. That is your cross. After you've dusted that, you put your bag back on and you leave it until the fruit is mature sometime in September. You harvest your crop. And then here you got your berries and everything. You got to get rid of all of the pulp and whatnot. You push them through a hardware cloth screen, different size, which pushes the seeds through until you come to a small size, and the seeds stick on the top part of the screen. The rest of the pulp goes through. So now you have your seeds. You wash them off, let them dry out on a napkin or something in the lab, and then finally put it into a small, either plastic bag or a small coin envelope until that winter. So now in 1974, okay. So here now in November of 74, we got our seed, we're ready to go. Now we have to process that seed. Well, the first thing you do is you take your seed out and you put it in a beaker of water and you swish it around to see how many of those seeds will float. If they float, they're generally empty. There's no embryo inside. So if you have a lot like this, you plant it very thick in your bed. If you have most of the ones that sink, then you're careful to separate them out in your flat. So in other words, first you give the old flotation test to get some idea if you made a good cross or not. And back when this cross was originally made, it was given a letter and a number. In other words, it was the S series for that particular year. And this particular cross of Alicante Gans with Trousseau was his number 8. Now he had also another cross with an S series, and he had another set of varieties in here, and he gave that S26. And one of those turned out to be royalty. All right, you've got your seeds, you got them soaked, now you're ready to plant. So sometime in November, you will plant your seeds in sterilized soil in a flat, about a 2-inch flat here, and you'll plant them down about a 1/2 inch, and you spread them all through this flat. Now, sometimes you'll have small lots because you make more than one cross here. You might make up to about 60 crosses. So you'll go, say, from S1 to S60. So each cross is different. Now, if you got a small lot, you'll divide this flat in half. You'll put some markers in there, and this will be might be S2. This might be S4 over here. So you have all your seeds in here, and you're covering about a 1/2 inch of sterilized soil. Then you take and you put your flats outside to let them get their chilling. Now, grape seeds have a chilling of about 6 weeks. So after they've been chilled outside over the winter, about in end of February, you take these into the greenhouse. And you plant, put those on the table. In about 3 weeks, say, they all start germinating on you. And then when they get up about 3 inches high, you transplant them into a larger bed. In other words, now you have a large bed that has sides on it about 6 inches high, and this is all sterilized soil in here. You'll transfer these into here, and you give them about 1.5 to 2 inches apart, right down the row. And you keep track of all your particular crosses this way. Okay, these grow. When they get up about this high, you transplant those out into the field, right down the row. Now, you've only got between 10,000 and 15,000 of these to plant each year. So you can't plant them 8 by 12 like we generally do out here in our vineyard. You've got to conserve space. And the only way to conserve space is to plant these a little closer. So when you go out in the vineyard there and you see vines planted between 2 and 3 feet apart, this is what you see out there. You see these seedlings. Okay, so 1974, we have our seed, and we have it planted here. So 1975, we have our seedlings, and they come up. Now, we transplant here, and we transplant here out into the field. We have two transplanting jobs. With the labor pinch we've had with the finances, Dr. Olmo has changed his ways of living. He had to cut down on one of these. So here's what he does now. When he plants these seeds, he, instead of going into a flat here, he plants them in the greenhouse in this big bed. And then he opens up the greenhouse and leaves it freeze in there until the end of February. Then he closes down the greenhouse, warms it up, and he saved his operation of having to transplant into your larger beds. So now, when these things get up, about 8 to 12 inches, sometime in June then, they go directly out into the field. In other words, he pulls them up, bare root. They're growing, they're bare root. But he has to keep them plenty wet. And he plants it right out there in the field, and as he's planting, the water is running right down the row. So as soon as that's planted, the water's coming right to it. Otherwise, those things wilt right now. So in other words, this takes that tender, loving care, similar to what I've been telling you in the class about handling these little 3-inch peat pots. This requires that same kind of care. But this is a system he uses now to get these seedlings in the field. His percent loss is very low. But the first year then, 1975, he's in the field, and it will be allowed to grow as a bush. 1976, it will be brought up the stake. And ...1977, some will produce fruit for the first time. Some. The more vigorous ones, the ones that have a little more soup to them, will produce fruit. 1978, there'll be a few more come into production. 1979, by that time, practically all of them are bearing fruit. So from 1974, 5 years later, then you've got, let's say, your first production on them. Then, for 5 years, he takes production records, vigor records, all this data. In other words, he wants to find out what the vigor is like, what the fruit is like. He analyzes the fruit shape, flavor, size of the berries, everything to it, as well as make wine samples. Okay, at the end of 5 years then, he selects out what he feels are his best seedlings in that lot. And there might be, let's say, 8 to 10 seedlings that look real good. They have the right kind of a cluster, it's not too tight. The vines seem to be producing good for a vine that's crowded about 2 feet apart. And the wine sample, which is a very small wine sample, I think he makes a fifth. He starts with a half a gallon, ends up with a fifth. 5 years of wine testing has indicated that these are making superior wines. Then, from this data, he knows whether the varieties have a high acid and bear early, mature early in the season, or they have a mediocre or a low acid and are mid-season to late in maturity. If they're early in maturity and have a low acid, he'll try them up in the Napa Valley in the coast counties. If they are mid-season or late in maturity and have a high acid, then the high acid types he tests down in the valley. So right now he is testing in two locations. At the Oakville plot in the Napa Valley, at the Kearney Field Station at Fresno. These are the two locations. So he's not only testing wine varieties, he's also testing table varieties. And the table varieties, of course, are primarily down the valley.
Why couldn't he just bud onto an already growing rootstock of some sort and save a few rootstocks?
Well, that's the way he got into trouble. I'll tell you about that. Yeah, remind me if I don't. Okay. So, well, now we've selected out about 8 to 10 good seedlings. And he will put this into about a 12-vine lot. In other words, down there, he puts about, let's say, 12 vines of the particular seedling. This is a large lot now. So this will give him, for wine varieties or even for table varieties, enough to pack out into, say, boxes for table to look at them, large number, but also enough fruit to make a decent sample of wine. Because these large lots now are brought up to Davis here, where you'll make a minimum of 5 gallons and generally more than that. So in other words, you can test them on a semi-commercial scale. So now this goes on This will go on for 4 to 5 years. Now, while this is going on for 4 to 5 years, it's not only being tested here at the tasting group, but after about 2 to 3 years, the ones that look the best, then he has the wine advisory board group. In other words, this is a group of about 7 or 8 of the leading winemakers of your main wineries. They will be invited to come here maybe twice a year and taste what he feels are the best selections in the group. And they'll taste and say, this one here, this P41 is a good one, and then this P47 is a good one. In other words, there's about maybe 2 or 3 of these selections that the wine people say, these are the ones that we should concentrate on. So this is now what he decides to choose. Now, just about this time here, when he's narrowed this down to about 2 or 3 selections, he takes cuttings off of vines that are on their own roots and gives them to the plant pathologist to have them tested for virus diseases. So by the time he's ready to release, hopefully the pathologist has them tested, and if they're diseased, they're cleaned up and they're ready to go. And then once they're ready to go, they're released to these nurseries that are in the business for rapid propagation. Because remember now, he's only starting with about maybe 2 vines. So you don't have much to start with. So these have to be built up in a hurry. So this is the present procedure they are now using to build these up in a hurry. So there's 2 vines now. So there's recently been a release called Carnelian. It took them over a year to decide on the name. First, the wine advisory board said, now this name here is a good one. And when they looked into it, they found out some winery down here in Timbuktu had that name already. So they couldn't use it. But then they thought of some more good names. And they finally chose another one here. Well, no, somebody else over here has it. Well, finally they had a real good name that somebody else had it. And they talked to that winery, and it wasn't too important a variety. And he was willing to relinquish his name so they could name this new variety. So now we have Carnelian.
Do they go to the FPMS all the time, or?
The present procedure is to go through FPMS, so when it is released, it goes out as clean stock, yes. And this will be the first variety that has been patented. Up till now, the varieties have not been patented. So in other words, if we had, say, 5 years of testing here and 5 years of testing here, and 2 to 3 years of testing here, you can see it's going to take more than 10 years to get out a new variety. So it doesn't go fast. It takes 2 years minimum to go through the virus. If it's clean to start with, 2 years of testing you'll have. But if it's not clean to test to start with, they have to put it through heat treatment for 1 year. And then when they get enough wood, it takes 2 years to test it. So it's a minimum of 2 years. Okay, now, this is the way most new varieties have been developed. But there are a few other developments. Let me go back here. I got to tell you about a couple other ones now. There has been one development by open pollination. Now, this is also crossing, but it wasn't a controlled cross like I've been telling you about. And you've heard of the variety Calmeria. USDA picked that out of a bunch of seed of Almeria. They planted it and selected this one out, and this is, they named it Calmeria. And then another very rare one is by bud mutation. Back in Arizona in 1960, on the cardinal variety, they had one that came out about 2 weeks earlier, 10 days to 2 weeks earlier. It looked very much like cardinal. The berries might have been a little smaller, but it looked very good, and it was one of these bud mutations that occurred out in the vineyard. The grower happened to be well-versed enough that he recognized this thing always came out a week to 10 days earlier than the rest of the vineyard. So he propagated that separately, and sure enough, he developed a vineyard that was a week earlier than the rest of his cardinals, and when you come in a week earlier, boy, you skim the cream off the crop. So this fellow was named Wayne Thornburg. And he called that thing Robin. Only he was a smart customer. He put a patent on it right away. And one of these big packers bought the patent, and they took it all to themselves, planted it all to themselves, and don't let anybody be caught trying to grow this, or you're in trouble. You got a lawsuit against you. So this is why you don't see this grown commercially anyplace except by just that one patent holder. But this occurred as a bud mutation. Okay, now we'll get back here on the list. Now, the question was raised, well, shucks, the way Dr. Olmo does, he raises these seedlings and it takes 3 or 4 years to come into bearing. Shucks, if you grafted them on a nice big stock like that, you'd have fruit the next year, and I agree. And this is exactly what happened to Ruby Cabernet. When he developed Ruby Cabernet, he wanted to blow it up faster, so he put it on one of our rootstocks here. Only one catch. Our rootstock was carrying one of our virus diseases. So he loused up the whole lot. And when we first started this selection work for a clean stock program, trying to find clean stocks to begin with, we took 3 years and finally decided, well, you can't find a clean Ruby Cabernet. And finally, Dr. Goheen developed the heat treatment and was able to clean it up. But there were several varieties that were developed, new varieties, and they came out not clean. They came out loused up. And it was a heck of a time to clean it up. So because of this, we no longer graft one of these seedlings on a rootstock, unless you're sure it's going to be clean.
Aren't they developing clean rootstocks?
Fine. Now, if you're sure, that's what I said, unless you're sure it's going to be clean, then you can go that way. But to really play safe, it's best to maintain, say, a one vine from a cutting someplace over here on its own roots, where you use that strictly for blowing up if it pans out. But as far as testing, if you want to test a variety, say put it on clean rootstocks, it'll grow much faster and you can fruit it much earlier and you can test it quicker. That's one way to do it. And USDA has tested that in the past. Use this system for testing their seedlings.
But won't there be differences in the
fruit? Sure. When you go onto a rootstock, it never looks the same as a variety on its own roots. So you do have differences. Now, as far as our varieties that we find in nature, we don't find them like we find our present growing varieties. Our present growing varieties are perfect flowered, meaning they're both female and male combined. In other words, the pollen is good on the pistil itself. It sets seed by itself, so it's perfect flowered. And you don't have to have a pollen parent like you have to have with cherries or almonds. It's very nice. But that isn't the way it occurred in nature, not by a long shot. Actually, the historical origin of our grape, you find the vines are either male or female. So in other words, they're not self-fruitful. And it has taken all of this breeding that's been going on for years and years and years to develop our varieties that are self-fruitful, that are perfect flowered, so you don't have to have a pollinizer. Now, in our grape, in our vinifera, they have these carriers of heredity, and they're called chromosomes. These are the things that carry all, every character, even you, everybody has chromosomes. And in vinifera, you have 19 pairs. And that's nice, but they're very, very small. Also, in Labrusca, you have 19 pairs, which makes it very nice, because if you have varieties or species with the same pairs, you can cross them easily, that there's no problem. But then you come to rotundifolia. And that has 20 pairs. Well, son of a gun, something doesn't add up there. Because if you try to pair this with this, there's always going to be some oddball out there. And when you start losing chromosomes someplace, it ain't going to work. So in other words, these two will not cross at all. You can't cross them. In under ordinary circumstances, it won't cross. But rotundifolia has all the best characters we want. It's resistant to Pierce's disease. It's grown over in the southeastern states where you have a high incidence of Pierce's disease. It has resistance to that. It has resistance to mildew. It's very vigorous. It's terrific. And it would be excellent for breeding to develop these two types of resistance into our viniferas. If we could have, say, viniferas that we didn't have to sulfur, that would be an excellent advantage. And if we had vinifera varieties that were not susceptible to some of our virus diseases, that would be a terrific advantage, too. Well, rotundifolia offers at least two of these advantages. So the breeder has been trying for years to cross these. Ordinarily, they won't cross. Back about 1940s, we had one of our Indian students here, Mr. Patel, who got interested in this, and he tried it. And he crossed vinifera, some varieties, with rotundifolia. He made the cross that direction, and he also tried rotundifolia with vinifera. In other words, he made reciprocal crosses. Well, on his rotundifolia vinifera, where the rotundifolia was the female parent, he got exactly goose egg. It didn't work. And fortunately, he had some of these crosses here, and he got a few seeds that were viable. So in other words, he broke the barrier. And this is the reason now that we have some of these hybrids that are coming along now that have this resistance in them. The fruit is not the best, not by a long shot. We haven't gotten up here with quality yet, but we're getting decent production. And we've got the resistance incorporated into it. So we've got the barrier broken, and there's additional crossing being made on these to give, hopefully, vigorous, good quality varieties that will have the resistance to Pierce's disease and the resistance to mildew, so you won't have to do any sulfuring. They've checked the chromosome number, but I can't tell you what it is. I don't know. I could check with Olmo and find out, but this is something I don't know what it is.
But doesn't this follow the same story as the French hybrids?
Very much so.
The French hybrids plunked out because they carried the bad flavor of the Brussels. What's going to prevent the rotundifolia from carrying the bad flavor of rotundifolia?
Well, so far, the flavor is not in there, so that they're continuing to outcross with vinifera, hoping to bring in the better flavors of the better vinifera varieties, but still maintain those two resistances that they have. We haven't achieved this yet. In other words, we're on the upward hill trying to get this. So there might be a few years before we'll have this. Jed?
Yeah, who said the breast is bad?
Well, that's a personal preference. I thought it was at first, too, but I've become acclimated to it, just like eating avocados.
Aren't a large number of these being bred to be rotundifolia rootstocks so that you can have a compatibility in grafting?
Fine, yes. That's also another thing, because they make an excellent rootstock, and the vinifera will not graft or bud onto a rotundifolia. But by breaking this barrier, now it is possible we can get rootstocks that will graft. And that's as far as we go this morning.